This is the story of the world's first economic bubble. It is a story of the most desired flower of the 17th century, the flower that aroused extraordinary passions, the tulip. During the 17th century, the tulip had become so greatly desired in the Netherlands that a tulip auction in 1637 proved to have raised a total of 90,000 guilders, which was a fortune in those days. Traders were buying and selling a single bulb of tulip for hundreds, even thousands of guilders, and building paper profits. By the middle of 16th century, tulip was becoming much more commonplace within the Ottoman Empire, and Turks were making plentiful use of the flower's image. Tulips were embroidered onto prayer rugs, painted on the walls, on the settles, and so on. The sultans also decorated their palaces with tulips and other flowers. By the middle of 16th century, the tulip had come to Europe's notice, and by 1620, the fashion for tulip spread throughout Europe and it quickly overshadowed rivals such as lily and carnation. Tulip was soon considered a symbol of wealth and good taste. Botanical tulips are known for their robust and simple color schemes. So how did these celebrated flowers become so elaborately colored? The answer is rather disturbing. They were diseased. The great irony about the tulip mania is that the most popular varieties and the most expensive varieties of these tulips were infected with a disease. It was this disease that caused the spectacular intensity and variations in the colors of their petals, and that explained why tulips, among other flowers of the garden, displayed the distinct, intense, and brilliant colors that collectors came to crave. The popularity of the new flower was such that garden lovers soon began to strive to undo each other by producing even more dazzling and brilliantly colored varieties. But there was a scarcity of tulips in the 17th century Holland. The tulip was not a readily available flower and was only available in strict quantities. Because most of the fine varieties were scarce, they were desired, and because they were desired, they were very expensive. And because they were expensive, they were extremely lucrative to grow. In the 17th century, almost all Dutch artisans worked long hours for low wages. The artisan class included the weavers, the carpenters, smiths, cobblers, and market tradesmen. This artisan class saw a demand for tulips and the instant profits it seemed to promise. This is what made the appeal for tulips so tempting for so many poor Dutchmen. As the demand for the bulb grew and the prices quoted for a particular variety increased year after year, it became obvious that there was money to be made in the flower trade. Now here's the really interesting part. For three decades before the tulip mania, flower lovers had used money to buy tulips. But now, for the first time, tulips were being used as money. And just as strikingly, these bulbs were valued at huge sums. As the number of people attracted to the bulb trade grew, the price of the most favored varieties began to rise. This rise was slow at first, but the prices began to rise rapidly in 1634, and this acceleration continued until the winter of 1636. For a while at least, all traders made money, which in turn pushed more people into this trade. Tulip mania climaxed in just 2 months, December 1636 and January of 1637. In these few weeks, money poured into the bulb trade as Dutchmen rushed to invest whatever they possessed in the bulbs. The most celebrated of all tulips, Semper Augustus, rose from 5,500 guilders a bulb to an astonishing 10,000 guilders. To put this number in perspective, 10,000 guilders would have been sufficient to purchase one of the grandest of homes in Amsterdam. Let that sink in for a moment. One tulip bulb for the price of a grand home. As the autumn of 1636 shaded into winter, it all seemed well for the flower business. The number of florists and the number of bulbs in circulation both continued to increase. Prices rose steadily and profits were enormous. Yet in reality, the tulip trade that the florist had built rested on the shakiest of foundations. In most respects, all that was required for the boom in tulip prices to turn into a full-fledged mania was now in place. And it was the first week of February 1637. The boom time was over. The crash in tulip prices began in Harlem, when a group of florists gathered to auction off their bulbs in the usual way in one of the city's taverns. the florist offered a fine tulip for sale for some 1250 guilders. In the normal course of event, he would have found several eager buyers for this price. On this day, however, there were no bidders at all for the bulb at this price. The auctioneer, puzzled, then offered a discounted rate of 1100 guilders, then 1000 guilders, and so on. Still no bidders. It is easy to imagine the awkward silence that must have descended upon the group of florists. And this was the beginning of the panic. It only took a few days for the panic to spread throughout the rest of Netherlands. In town after town, desperate florists discovered that their flowers that were worth thousands of guilders only a day or two ago were now worthless and could not be sold at any price. The market for tulips simply ceased to exist. A large number of the population had sold or mortgaged off their possessions to finance their dealings in the bulb market. Those who were in this desperate position faced not merely loss, but ruins. And so ended the tulip mania. But even 100 years later, the tulip mania remained a raw and vivid scar upon the national psyche of the Dutch. And thanks in good measure to the pamphleteers and painters of the Golden Age, the very idea that a bulb could have been traded for such colossal sums strikes many as perfectly ridiculous. This, for example, is a famous painting from around 1640. The painter here is mocking the speculators, depicting them as brainless monkeys who are buying and selling tulips for enormous amounts. On the bright side, however, the whole of Europe had now heard of the tulips, and many people wanted to see for themselves the flower that generated such passions. Dutch florists were thus able to offset some of their losses by developing an export business. As for the tulip mania, well, that is one virus that never disappeared. It was always purely a human disease, one that fed on human emotions of greed for money. And it still breaks out occasionally in one form or another. This tale is a cautionary one, and the first real example of an economic bubble.